You have just finished up the suspension on your car. You've put new control arms in. You've put new bushings in. You've put new springs in. You've put new shocks in. So you're gonna take that sucker down off the jacks. You got the jack stands out and you pull it down and it does this. You got trouble. Cause that's right-eyed. What are you gonna do? One thing you need to do is to like and subscribe to the channel. Go out and leave a comment in the section below. Also, check out our Patreon account and check the description below for any parts that we may list. Everything is in there with the website ready to go. And after the break, we're going to show you, well, tell you how to fix this. Suspension parts for your car. National Parts Depot has suspension parts for classic cars in stock. Something that not everybody can say. You can get these parts from one of the four convenient locations across the United States. They have a location in Ocala, Florida. They have a location in Charlotte, North Carolina. Another location in Detroit, Michigan. And a location in Ventura, California. Guaranteeing that you can get your parts within 3 to 4 business days inside the continental United States. They have a toll-free number with people on there 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, nearly 365 days a year. You can also go out to their website and check out the website for parts. They have the stuff there listed, and if it's in stock, they'll show it there so you'll know what you're getting and when you're going to be able to get it. National Parts Depot is a great place to work with. We've worked with them for years. We like them. We'd like for you to check them out and try them. Hey, guys. Good to see you here. Hey, I've got cam up underneath the car. We're going to show you what you want in a ride height. You've gone in and done all the cool stuff. You've put all the new parts on it, brand new springs, brand new shocks, brand new bushings. If you can only get bushings for your particular brand of car, or brand new upper and lower control arms, if those are available, you've dropped it down and here's where you're at. But what you really want is this. So what's happened is when you lift the car up in the air, your tires are actually sitting either this way or this way, depending on the car. And when they're like this and the car goes back to ride height, they're actually sitting out, which is causing your suspension to sit a little higher than it normally would. What you would want to be able to do is to roll the car backwards and forwards a little bit, jounce the front suspension, and then it will settle into its final ride height. I'm not going to do that here, but I can actually go in and just put some pressure on the front end of the car and actually make it drop. So this is pretty close to our final ride height on the 69 Fairlane wagon. But you're not here. You're back up there. So we're going to start talking about right now is ways to get to your final ride height on your classic car. And Cam's going to come in and we're going to talk about a couple of things here to get you here rather than, you know, stilty or maybe fuel-y drag car front end, which is fine if you have one of those straight axle front end cars, but this ain't no straight axle front end car. So you're panicking.
Yes.
Because it's it's sitting like
a gasser or like a donk.
Yeah. It may be the look you're looking for.
That wasn't the point of your build. But
is what you're looking for, and you now have a donk or a gasser. Yeah. You're in a dead panic. You spent all that money. Mm. But I'm saying you don't have to dead panic yet.
Yeah.
And one of the first things you want to check
is make sure that you didn't tighten the control arm bolts when it is up in the air. You want to tighten the bolts with it actually dropped at ride height because there's a steel insert in there and it'll actually act like a torsion spring inside the bushing.
Yeah, because you can actually rip those bushings too. And then that can act on some suspensions that can cause you problems because you've wrecked the vulcanizing that they did to the steel bushing on the inside.
Yep, and it'll just completely eat itself apart.
Right, because then it's got too much play in it, and that motion will cause it to just roll the rubber up, and then pretty soon it's no good.
Yeah, and you're back to square one of having to put bushings back in it.
And if you do the same thing again, it's going to be a problem. Yeah. Also, whenever it's like this, don't panic and think it's the spring initially. That's not necessarily the case, because when you push put the thing on the ground, the suspension, as I said before, is either going to rock out or rock in. You'll be sitting on the edge of the tires. Jounce the front end with it loose so that you can get the thing to sit mostly on its normal ride height. Heck, I've even seen guys where they'll go in, they'll roll it backward and forward just a little bit so that the tires will flatten out and then go in and adjust the suspension. But there's other things at play here that we're going to talk about. So what I'm about to tell you is shocking.
Heart.
Dad joke.
Stepdad joke. Even worse.
Leave me alone, man. I'm trying to do a levity, a little comedy here. Anyway, we're going to be talking about right now is shocks. And one of the things a lot of guys don't realize is that shocks can add spring rate to the front of the vehicle. If you buy a GT-style spring, we're not going to go into the whole thing about 720 springs and all that stuff, but suffice to say, if you go to somebody like Eaton Detroit and you buy a GT spring, which is a more high-rate coil, you will be adding spring rate to the car because the gas shock stays up all the time. These cars were not designed to run a gas shock. They were designed to run a standard hydraulic shock with no gas pressurization at all. So shocks like QA1 or Viking, to my mind, are a little bit more preferred in an application like this. I know everybody wants to save all the money in the world when they're working on their classic car, but in all honesty, shocks are probably one place that you shouldn't try to save money. For instance, this one was not this low before we put the shocks on the front of it, which are QA1s. It was up more. We had fender room and clearance at the wheel wells that we just ain't got no more.
Now we can't fit the jack under.
It's true. It is now so low that you cannot put anything but our low-rise floor jack underneath the car. The regular jack, and I don't even think the low-rise will fit in the center cross member. We have to take the cup off of it to get it to fit. So, So it makes it more tight. And the other thing we did on this one was we put the roller bearing spring purchase, which will also, oddly enough, remove a little bit of ride height from the vehicle. So if you have something that uses spring perches, like the Novas, the early Novas, or the Mustang, Falcon, Fairlane, any of those kind of cars, and they offer a roller spring perch, and you're trying to get your ride height down, that is one way to help reduce it because it also will make it handle a little bit better too. But beyond that, it will also reduce the ride height. And like I said, the shocks are the biggest thing in that because that will... drop the car. We have graphic proof on this one because we have coils cut, which is the next thing we're going to be talking about. So now we're going to be talking about springs and things you should and shouldn't do. Now, one of the things I'm going to say about this is if you're at that dead panic moment because the front end's not sitting where you wanted to, you can
cut a coil.
I don't recommend cutting one whole coil, though.
Yeah, that's pretty drastic for the first try.
It is very drastic because you're going to drop the front end probably at least an inch by cutting a coil, typically.
And especially if you haven't actually driven it and let the suspension settle in really where it's going to be. Because if it's brand new coils, you're supposed to give it about 200 to 500 miles of really hardcore driving anyway.
What does Mike Eaton at Eaton Detroit Springs say? Drive it like you stole it for 500 miles.
Yeah, drive it like you stole it from somebody that stole it.
I don't think he says that, but I'll tell him that. I'm sure he'll use it.
So you can cut coils if your springs are a little bit too tall. Don't use a torch because you will anneal it and destroy the spring.
And there's only certain springs you can cut. There are two different types of springs that were used on these cars. There's a closed coil, and then there's also the open coil, which just goes out and it goes on.
Yeah, and it's just like a regular coil. And
I would call it a pigtail. The pigtail type that just hangs down.
Yep. And it just ends.
Yeah, and those can be cut.
Yeah.
The other type, you're done.
Yeah, if it sits on a flat perch, like in a Mustang, the upper perch in the shock tower, that side can't be cut, but the bottom side that goes towards the control arm can be.
Right. So. And don't, whatever you do, use a torch to soften the spring to get the front end to come down.
The adjustable coils.
I've actually seen people do this, and it goes back to what we were talking about with annealing the metal. The metal will fatigue and anneal, and one day you'll just be driving down the road and suddenly one of the springs just says, you know what, today is a good day to die. The only thing that will be keeping your spring in place is the shock. So, at least on a Mustang. Yeah. Some cars, that's not necessarily the case. So don't use a torch to, you know, heat the metal on the coil to get the coil to drop. Bad juju. You are way better off contacting your manufacturer, going in and getting another set of coils done. Now, speaking of pigtails, one of the things you want to do if you're running a Mustang, Fairlane, Falcon, or Nova, and it has the spring with the wind-out that goes to the spring perch, you'll want to make sure that the spring, the tail end of the spring, is actually up against the stop on the spring perch. If it's not, your spring is not going to be in the right place, and it's actually going to add a little bit of ride height. Also, you need to make sure that in the top of the spring, that the spring cup assembly is where it needs to be. If the spring is kicked off one way or the other in the top of the spring cup area, it's going to add ride height to it. You're going to see this as being a theme with the things I'm talking about. You need to make sure all your stuff is exactly where it's supposed to be to make sure that that ride height is correct. Now, another thing I want to talk about is the fact that springs can be different heights.
Mm-hmm.
We've actually had that, I believe, on your 66 originally.
Yeah. The original springs were way different.
Yeah, you had one. It was almost like an inch.
Yeah.
Now, to have a little bit of difference isn't that bad. I mean, if you have a 16th or an eighth of an inch of difference on either side, even a half inch side to side on the car, you actually probably are not going to notice that in driving it. But if you're sitting here and it's an inch off on one side, you've got a problem, mm-hmm. and you probably have a spring that's not set up and run with the other one. What I'll tell you is, contact your manufacturer. Don't call them pissed off. Just say, hey man, one of my springs is not the same height as the other one when I sit the car down. Two things you'll want to do in that case. You'll want to check your chassis.
Yep.
Make sure you don't
have make sure the chassis is straight.
It's 66. Whee!
The spring height was probably to compensate for dropped frame horns.
That car is in such bad shape. Oh my gosh. Anyway, you need to check the chassis and make sure you don't have any problems with it. Check for body damage, check for all that kind of stuff. If the car's sitting unlevel, make sure it's not a chassis issue. You know, I have actually seen, this is good. I've actually seen a Mustang where someone bought it, the car had been hit and was actually rocked. When they put it together, they cut a half a coil out of it to make the front end sit correctly.
Just feel a little bit in the seat like you're sitting a little bit sideways, though.
You'll see all kind of stuff. We've actually talked about doing a show where it's all about the stupid crap that we see on the internet. Just stupid fixes for things.
Or like, the stuff you see at a car show that you weren't supposed to see.
Yeah. Cannot be unseen. Okay, folks, that's our show for this week. We wanted to go over this because of the Facebook post that I saw. There was a post on Facebook. I'm not going to say the groups or any of that kind of stuff because I'm on, like, I don't know, 15 or 20 different groups trying to help guys out with stuff. And there was so much hard misinformation being applied to that post that I was like, we really need to talk about this. I didn't want to spend a lot of time on it, but this is something that I felt was important enough to interrupt our working schedule in order to talk about what can happen whenever you're setting the front end back down on the ground. We'll be doing a lot of suspension install stuff on the Ranchero and on the 64 Falcon hardtop in the near future. But this is something that everybody's going to deal with.
Yes.
If you run a classic, this can be a problem on your car. And so with that happy little note being said and our pigtail suspension being ready to go, we're going to go now and spend the rest of the afternoon working on the transmission, which is still
not finished.
You guys have a great week. We'll see you next time on
Autorestomod.
Let's get her back up in the air and see if we can make the drive shaft window.